Hello dear students, in the previous video we studied about integration of the princely states. In today's video we will study about reorganization of states. Dear students, as you know, along with the independence, India was also divided into India and Pakistan, and there were a number of small princely states present in India that time. So it was a great challenge before the Indian leaders to make those princely states united and make one India. So after the unification of these princely states, especially by the Sardar Vallabhbhai Patel, there was one more major challenge before these leaders, that was reorganization of states. Dear students, as states joined India, so it was a challenge how to draw new boundaries of those states. And the leader considered that boundaries of these states must be drawn in such a way that the linguistic and cultural diversity, plurality of these states, regions in India must be saved. So it was not an easy task. During the British rule, the boundaries of these two states were drawn either on administrative convenience or simply coincided with the territories annexed by the British government or territories ruled by princely states. So these were two, if not two, only one concept of boundaries that was done by the British, that was administrative basis, and second one was optional. But our national movement, especially the leaders, had rejected these divisions and called them artificial. They provoked the linguistic division of princely states, of boundaries, and in fact Congress also, the Indian National Congress also, done with itself after Nagpur session of Congress in 1920. After this session, Indian National Congress was also reorganized, as there were many Congress parties were framed in different Indian regions. So after 1920, Nagpur session of Indian National Congress, those small parties were to be organized in the main Congress party. Things changed after independence and partition. Our leaders felt that carving out states on the basis of language, but this is story. When the people, when the national leaders believed that princely states must be organized on the basis of language, but as the time changed, the Indian leaders after independence felt that the creation of any state on linguistic basis may create unrest in other parts of India. So now they are against the creation of any state on the basis of language. It was also felt that this would draw attention, okay. They were fearing that if we create one state on the basis of language, then other people will also demand for other states on the basis of language, and India will divide into so many states. So the central leadership decided to postpone the matter. The need for postponement was also felt because the fate of princely states had not been decided. Because the princely states' fate was not yet decided, that's why the National movement's leader postponed the idea of creation of new states on the basis of language. The decision of national leadership was challenged by the local leaders and the people. When the central leadership postponed the idea of creating new states on the basis of language, the people of different regions, small leaders or regional leaders began to protest again against Indian central leadership. And the protest began in Telugu speaking areas of Madras province that time. And that area that time was falling under the Tamil Nadu, some parts of Andhra, Kerala and Karnataka. And the Vishal Andhra movement, as the movement for separate Andhra Pradesh was called, demanded that the Telugu speaking areas should be separated from Madras province, of which they were a part, and be made into separate Andhra province. So the people of that today's Andhra Pradesh area demanded that they must be given a separate state, or the people who speak Telugu must be given a separate state that was called Andhra Pradesh in the Vishal Andhra movement. Nearly all the political forces in Andhra Pradesh at that time, there were small parties in Andhra Pradesh, small political parties. All those small political parties joined the movement, and that's why the power of that movement also increased. The movement gathered momentum as a result of central government's vacillation. Potti Sri Ramallu, a Congress leader and a veteran Gandhian, went on an indefinite fast and led to his death after 56 days. After the movement got momentum, there was a Congress leader, Potti Sri Ramallu, went on indefinite hunger strike, and after 56 days of strike, the leader Potti Sri Ramallu was died. And the death of Potti Sri Ramallu caused unrest in the whole area. People were involved in violence, and the loss of everything went on. People killed one another, caused loss to public property, and the streets were full of violence. Many were injured, some of them lost their lives in police firing. In Madras, several legislators resigned their seats in protest. That's why in Madras region, several legislators resigned from their seat in protest of the movement. Finally, Prime Minister announced the formation of separate Andhra Pradesh in December 1952. Formally, the Prime Minister Jawaharlal Nehru announced for the creation new separate state Andhra Pradesh on the basis of language or linguistic basis in 1952. So Andhra Pradesh became first state to be created on linguistic basis. And look at this map, and downside of this map, there are some questions. You have to answer those questions yourselves. So for formation of Andhra Pradesh spurred the struggle for making of other states on linguistic lines in other parts of country. So as it was thought by the central leaders that on the formation of one linguistic state, the demand from other regions will also be raised. It was the same when the demands from other regions also were short. So these struggles forced the central government into appointing a state reorganization commission in 1953. That's why central government framed a state reorganization commission in 1953 to look into the question, to check the question whether the boundaries of states must be drawn on the basis of linguistic or not. The commission in its reports accepted the boundaries of the state should reflect the boundaries of different languages, and the commission accepted the recommendations and recommended that the boundaries of states must be reflect different languages. On the basis of its report, the States Recognition Act was passed in 1956. This led to creation of 14 states and 6 union territories. On the basis of recommendations of the report, of State Reorganization Commission, the State Reorganization Act was passed in 1956, and at that time it created 14 states and 6 union territories. Look at the picture. What this is? 5th Feb 1956. Guess whose pictures are depicted through these cartoons. Guess and tell me in comment box. One of the most important concern in the early years was that demand of separate states would endanger the unity of India. So at the early stage of drawing lines on the basis of language, it was thought that the separation of countries on linguistic basis will be proved in danger or dangerous for the unity of India, but it was not so. But on the other hand, the division on the linguistic basis proved a boon to India and Indian government, as the different areas on the basis of language got chances to represent different communities, different areas in Indian parliament, rather than few English speaking people. It also provided a great strength to the unity of India. Now it is more than 50 years since the formation of linguistic states. We can say that linguistic states. So now it is time of more than 50 years since the formation of first linguistic state, that was Andhra in 1956. Some other states also were framed, as Gujarat was separated from Bombay, Haryana and Himachal Pradesh were also separated from Punjab, Nagaland, Arunachal Pradesh, they were also separated from their mother state or parent state. So this proved a blessings for India. Above all, linguistic states underline the acceptance of principle of diversity. Of all these things, the principle of linguistic states is to be believed that the principle provides us the principle of diversity. Means the people of different regions are present in India who speak different languages, follow different customs, and live in different climates also. When we see that India adopted democracy, it doesn't simply mean that India embraced a democratic constitution. When we say that India adopted democracy, then it doesn't mean that India is simply the country who enacted its constitution, or the government is ruling according to constitutions. Nor does it merely means that India adopted the format of elections, and nor it means that India adopted format of elections means the government is elected by the people, or the people are electing their own representatives. That is the basic pillar of democracy. The choice was larger than that, but the choice of linguistic states was more than that idea. It was a choice for in favor of recognizing and accepting the existence of differences, and which could at times be oppositional. And it was the idea of accepting different, various, or differently existing states, different language speaking states, which could be dangerous for India. Democracy, in other words, was associated with plurality of ideas and ways of life. Democracy, in other words, accepts the diversity of the culture, diversity of language, and other things. Much of the politics in the later period was to take place within this framework. So afterward, after India got freedom, some linguistic states were considered. Much of the framework took place later. Even states are framed today and will be framed in future also. So you have to study these points. Fast forward, creation of new states, you have to study yourself. So in this way, we completed this chapter today. And in next class, we will discuss next chapter. Till then, keep studying and take care of your health. Thank you.